John Cole with GrowingYourGreens.com to another exciting episode for you. Today we're at the world headquarters of the Boogie Brew Company. We got Josh here in person, live himself, to go over with you guys all the different kinds. Look at all these kinds of sugars. Like, there's no more videos on sugars than this video. This is the master video for sugars and feeding your soil the best sugar in the world to feed your soil so that you guys get the performance, the terpenes, the different polyphenols and nutrients in your crops that you want. So Josh, number one is, you know, why the heck are we making a sugar video today? I've always resisted you telling me, John, you should make a sugar video. I'm like, okay, Josh, we got to finally do this. Why are we making a sugar video? Why is it so important for my viewers out there?
I'm just stunned. We turned this into the sugar video because of the sheer number of sugar, the different sugars there are on the market. And it just blew my mind when you sent me to the grow store, and I came back after having dropped over $200 on this stuff. Do you even need it to begin with? So we want this video to kind of be like the last word on sugars. And I'll tell you the last word. If you want to cut right to the end, you don't need none of this. You don't need any of it.
It's all BS. I never use sugars in my garden, my vegetable garden.
You don't need any of this. That's the God's honest truth, and I'm going to tell you how and why and why you may want to use sugars, and why you may as well not.
Cool. That's, oh my gosh, Josh, you summed it up. That's awesome. So yeah. I guess the first thing is, let's get into how you got fleeced at the grocery store and how many of you guys may still be getting fleeced. And at least don't get fleeced at the grocery store. Josh is going to tell you some honest, legitimate products or even how you could make your own for super pennies on the dollar. Save your money at the grocery store. So let's go ahead and do a tight shot on these grocery store fleece products that we got actually prices on. So now we focus in on the side of the table that has basically all the different sugar products you guys could buy from the grocery store, including actually bulk molasses, which is actually the best, I guess, price, you know, per the volume, because you got a 5 gallon bucket here for like 38. This is 38, this is 45, this is 25, this is like 9, 24, 24. And actually Josh's product you could find at better grocery stores than every grocery store would sell it. Sells this between $6 and $10 per pound. So why do they sell sugars at grocery stores?
Yeah, I mean, why do people use sugars? This begs the question. Sugars are related to microbe herding. When I first learned about using sugars for cannabis horticulture in the 1990s, I would read on the grow forums on thcfarmer.net and Ganja Farmer. Back then I was paranoid. I would go to the library and use their dial-up internet because I didn't want anyone tracking me. This was Operation Green Merchant. And these guys were talking about being a good microbe herder. Like your microbes are cattle, okay? And their pasture is the soil kingdom that you've given them. And the way to get those cattle, those microbes, to herd and stampede sometimes is to spike that soil with some sugar. The best analogy would be, okay, you've got flowering cannabis plants. They're 5-6 weeks into an 8-10 week flowering cycle. Generally in the last 2 weeks, those cannabis plants will have greedily, ideally, gobbled up most of the nutrition that's been organically furnished via slow release, you know, digestive absorption mechanisms from, let's say, some top dressings that were used earlier in flower when they were really eating the foods in the super soil. So you're talking your guanos, the foods that are used in a super soil, the kelps for potassium, the guanos for some phosphorus. But you now have a situation at the end of the life cycle where you don't want all the foods going in because you're trying to get them to where they're using it all and flushing out excess, even organic foods in too high of an amount, you know, left in the plant material does affect the taste. And you're trying to, at the same time, stimulate a whole bunch of microbial activity in what might otherwise be a somewhat tired soil. So think of it, analogy of a marathon runner, mile 24, you know, mile 22, 3, 4, 5 miles to go. Hit them with the glucose.
Yeah, the gel packs. They got the gel packs. Or maybe if you're going to do it naturally, you can eat some dates.
Right. I mean, and we're going to discuss the economics because that's what I'm floored about here is the hydro industry and the nerve it has to charge.
$45.
So the idea is you're creating a mad frenzy of feasting activity in soil microbiology, in the organisms, right? And it's been proven. I mean, even California Department of Feed and Ag, CDFA, who are very, should we say, diligent regulatory ag body. We call them CDFU sometimes. That's a different story. But they approve of sugar being listed as a microbe stimulant for soil. So now a lot of these products, they're also attempting to sell it to you as some sort of finishing nutrient. And so they're allowed to actually register it as a fertilizer. And what I noticed in what they put in these, all of these are just shamelessly overpriced products. It's unbelievable.
You're paying for water on most of these.
You're paying for water. You really are. They'll add like a bit of magnesium sulfate. I mean, there is some evidence that Epsom salts, that magnesium sulfate in tiny quantities towards the end of flower can stimulate trichome production. However, it needs to be very small quantities because any salts, organic or otherwise, are going to affect your taste. So you're trying to flush, but you're also trying to create this, you know what I mean, this like powerhouse of activity in the soil. And so ideally, if you've timed it right and you've done your top dressings in the first couple of weeks of flower, and now you're, you know, a month into that, it might need one more top dressing. And now as you get in the last few weeks, you want to just flush diluted compost teas. That's going to be part of the discussion of where you don't need sugars to begin with. And you want to start maybe, if you think it's necessary, using some sugar products to, you know, spike that key microbe activity and so on. This is going to work for grapes, all right, for higher polyphenol content. This is going to work for higher flavonoid contents in berries.
Tomatoes.
You can do this.
Your vegetable garden,
of course, guys.
I mean, this is just not a cannabis video. It's for growing anything.
I mean, as we all know by now, and as John has provided you with that magical bridge between grow culture and the knowledge that the best of that hippie grow culture can transmute to the, you know, would-be raised vegetables, raised garden.
Fruits
and vegetable growth. There's no question that you can learn from the best of the best, these hippie organic, you know, these microbe herders from back in the 1990s when I was first learning about using my favorite sugar, which we're going to get to in a minute, and it's not my product. It's part of my product. But none of these grow store products are worth buying, including mine, including Boogie Bricks. I'm serious. It cost me a lot of money and time and energy to produce this. This is still an honest product. But
it's the best one you could buy, but you don't even need them.
No, I'm going to rate this.
You'd say people should get molasses over your product.
Well, I'm always thinking in the eyes of my customers.
Yeah, because you were a grower back in the day, trying to pinch pennies and get the most for the least.
Right, so, you know, I'm on your team. I'm here to help you and not hurt you.
Not hurt you.
Not. I'll hurt you down the right path if you let me, if you're willing to put up with all my BSing, you know? I mean,
and he has a lot of it.
Right.
I went through a lot today.
He kept telling me, this has got to be a short video. I'm like, yeah, right. You know, look at all the products we have here. I mean, we could spend 10 minutes talking about each. But in all seriousness, you know, the stuff I put in here and the time it takes me to mix this, I'm on your team. I'm bang for your buck. If you're going to buy a grow store sugar sweetener product, I mean, to me, spare times, molasses. But, you know, you can go to feed stores and get the feed grade, feed industry price. It's just like azomite. You pay more for it at a grow store.
At a feed store.
Right. Feed is still the cheapest. Same with C90 even. You know, everything feed is the cheapest. Whether it's feed grade rock dust or feed grade salt or feed grade molasses. So spare time, thank you for having a sensibly priced molasses, a feed grade industry molasses, you know. But if you really want to go cheap, I mean, you can go cheaper than this still. And this is already best bang for your buck.
And this is a natural product, whereas these ones are, you know, like totally concocted with additives. And
there's some bizarre stuff. I mean, I'm really, shame on you, Scott. Shame on you. This guy is known as a genius, the man behind
it. And I thought that was like some pretty clean stuff, you know?
This guy, this company and Monster Gardens have done the industry so many more favors than the industry will ever do them. And I want to thank Monster for allowing me to go purchase all these, save my rather crusty looking receipt. I'm going to bring them all back. I just want to discuss these. I have no intention of using any of these, but Scott is the owner, the genius behind this brand, Nature's Nectar. And when I look at the price of what you're paying for a jug of water and sucrose and fructose, and there may be some miraculous ingredient that he can't list because of the regulatory powers that be. But, you know, I like being transparent, you know, and to me, that's just shame on anyone that buys.
It's $45. You could get this for $38, like way more.
I mean, we could sit here like we're QVFing C, yeah, you know. Right. I mean, this is all of these. This is ludicrous. I mean,
that one's probably the best deal because it's like solid. It's not in water, right?
This is similar to what you would pay for Boogie Bricks.
But he copied your name.
No, it's Bricks. All right, bro, what is Bricks? Okay, let's. Yeah,
what is Bricks?
Yeah,
I want you guys to grow high Bricks foods.
Everything.
Yeah,
right.
Fruits, vegetables, cannabis. Measure your Bricks, guys, in your tissue leaves.
What is Bricks? Now, Bricks is the dry, carbohydrate content, fiber-free, from a plant. So the sugar content of every plant.
But it also includes the minerals, dude. It's all the dissolved solids. Could be carbohydrate, could be other things.
It is the dried liquid content of the plant that is completely devoid of any cellulose. That would be the world's best juicer. Juicing your plants, all right, completely separating all the fiber.
You could use a garlic press, you know, to get out the liquid.
The best juicer with the most amazing filtration that no liquid fiber pieces get in there, right? You're talking Norman Walker juicer on steroids, right?
I wouldn't even use it anyway.
It would be a hypothetical. It would be like the best. I know, you know. Okay, we're not going to talk about Norman Walker juicer.
They went out of business because of the pandemic.
No.
They did. Seriously, last year, they're gone. But there's a pure juicer, which
Norwalk
is...
Norwalk?
Yes. Norwalk juicer is gone. American-made juicer company.
Norwalk, I mean, I owe my life to Norman Walker. Anyway, we're not going to talk about that right now. That's a different...
That's a different video.
Health is your wealth, you know. But if you were to take the juice and then put it through, like, the cannabis guys making your...
I got Bricks meters.
But I'm saying, hypothetically, I'm trying to tell your viewers what Bricks is. So it's the dried sugar... If you were to dehydrate that juice, as long as it's being filtered really well, all the fibers being removed, if you were then to take that liquid content of the plant and dry it without any fibrous material, what is left, the dried liquid content of the plant, is then its Bricks. It's literally the dried sugars in the plant.
It's more than sugars. It's the minerals and all the other solids. All the other solids.
But it's carbohydrate. It is carbohydrate content. There can even be amino acids in it. I mean, there absolutely are in all fruits and vegetables for that matter. But so it's like, that's why dried berry powder tastes so good, right?
It's concentrated.
Right. Dried everything, you're getting that Bricks flavor when you taste a dried fruit powder, berry powder, vegetable powder, you name it, all right? So that's what Bricks is. How do you achieve high Bricks? You don't actually need any of this. These can be helpful, though. They really can. But you're paying just too damn much. Going back to talking about, you know, being a bike bum, what bike shops would charge for a, you know, carb supplement, a carb drink, a glucose for cyclists, for endurance athletes, is still way too much to what we're going to talk about next, you know, the supermarket equivalents. However, compared to the absolute blatant ripoff model of the grow industry, you know, you go and spend on any designer... ISO Star in Europe is one of the brands I'm familiar with. They sponsor a bike team, you know, with their, you know, fructose and glucose and whatever, emergencies. And I mean, your sugar supplements that for cycling or for endurance athletes are overpriced. And there's just no need. Just eat a handful of dates, you know, or whatever. I mean, you get some of these dry sugars we're going to talk about. But they are still a good deal comparatively. And we're talking, you know, lawyers and doctors and dentists and guys with $10,000 carbon bikes, and even their market, even the industry that feeds them, is too afraid to charge what you poor growers have been just walking into stores and staring at a sea of plastic jugs and getting seduced by. It's a shame on any of us that ever bought this stuff. I'm ashamed to say I was one of those fools. Back in the day when I made my mad money, I thought it was a badge of honor to go into Marin Hydroponics and drop $1,000 on all kinds of stuff. So, oh, this has a nice label. Tell me about this. And then the sexy hippie goddess behind the counter finishes the sale. And I walk out of there with a bunch of plastic jugs and I'm $1,000 lighter in my pocket. Do you think any of that really boosted the Bricks levels in my plants or was necessary to begin with? Maybe, maybe not. Frequently, when you're dealing with this mentality of a customer who's been using deadrients to begin with, their soil's already depleted of the biolife and the microbial activity they need, whether it's a grape grower, a broccoli producer, or a soy farmer trying to have richer tasting beans, or yes indeed, a medical grower with your cannabis in your backyard. If you're doing it all with deadrients, you're already lagging, you're already behind, you know, you're already using an inferior home to then, why would you have a whole fleet, a whole herd of these happy, not in this case, not cattle, but microbes, you know, why would you put them in a factory farm setting? Why not give those cattle the free range, the pasture, the mineral rich, chlorophyll, natural hay soils, the alpine slopes where cattle naturally live? And they're getting everything they need and nothing they don't for the strongest, healthiest, whether it's, you know, their bovine structure, stuff we're not supposed to eat to begin with. But my whole point is, why would you do that to the soil you're trying? You're not growing plants, you're growing soil. And so, you know, guys who grow 100% synthetically in rock wool, they'll go out and spend hundreds of dollars on this overpriced crap in an attempt to sweeten, in an attempt to finally get what's never been there to begin with. Good microbial activity. So my whole point is, you keep hearing me say over and over again, you don't need any of this. If you've given them the main course, why do they need this dessert food source in the first place? So, you know, this one here, this is a good company, all right? He makes an amazing line of mycorrhizae. He actually grows his own micro. This is a green grow out of Windsor, all right? $38 out of everything here. It's the one I would feel by far the least ripped off walking out of the grow store. And he's pricing his, honestly, as at the sensible end of the spectrum for the grow industry. He and I both share something in common. I've been to trade shows with this guy, Mark, the genius behind the green grow. And we both shared the same sentiment that if we charge too little for products that he's been honestly trying to make, like his top dressings are amazing. It was called Nature's Pride. He now has to call it Pride Lands, poor guy, because some other baking company, some brand of Nature's Pride, whatever. But those are amazing high-grade top dressings, and they come loaded with his mycorrhizae. And right there, you're getting phosphorus conversion when you add that fungi, you know, to those really good quality organic phosphorus foods. And he's always tried to do what he does with his top dressings and his mycorrhizae, and even his bricks. You know, he and I both said, if we charge too little for our products in the grow stores, we're gonna just get kicked right out of there. You know, you need to come in looking like a baller. If you're a vendor and you're some brand, and you need to come in there charging some outrageous price for a sexy label. And his products and mine look too honest. That's the God's honest truth. I talk a lot, I never talk poop. You buy a single bottle plastic anything from the grow store, you're getting hosed.
This looks like the generic stuff I used to get. Yeah, my parents, you know, would go like, get in the car back in the day, and then all this stuff. I mean, that's a sexy bottle.
Apparently, now Monster told me amazing things about this. Jade at Monster, he said the crush, this stuff. So obviously, this is a grow industry product with some secret. But I look at what's in here. I mean, we don't have time in the supposed to be short video, like, to actually spell the ingredients.
Yeah, we can't go over
but
everyone, man.
You're getting hosed more or as much on these as you are when you buy a hydroponic nutrient. You mean a deadrient, something that kills soil life. And the other thing, this is cracks me up, because they're adding monopotassium phosphate. Like, this isn't even organic. This guy, I mean, his label's all about the best liquid organic products, nature's nectar. And so I don't know if it's a way around making it 010, giving it that fertilizer rating. Maybe that's the chemotocracy at work, telling the hydro industry, all right, you want to sell a sugar product? Well, you're going to have to register it as a fertilizer. Therefore, you have to buy some of our deadrients. I don't know. I don't understand how that works. But that's BS right there. That's straight up BS. And I'm sorry, but I just can't. When I look at what the ingredients are listed as, these are a joke. I don't have time to break them down. Go research them all yourself. We put the prices right here. You tell me which of these is the least ripoff to your dollar. You tell me. You give me your feedback.
Yeah, comment down below.
I want the comments. You all are better guinea pigs than I am. If it was me, I wouldn't buy any of these products. Not even my own, the Boogie Bricks. And I tell you all not to buy my Boogie Bricks. I'm going to give you the Working Man's Bricks recipe in a minute.
All right, Josh. Cool. So, stepping back a few minutes, right, I got some questions here, because some of my viewers probably have these questions too. Why do we need to spike the microbes and make them go crazy near the end of the grill. I mean, what does it do exactly to increase the bricks? We know that spiking microbes will increase bricks, increase terpenes. You know, you're going to create more polyphenols, but what's the mechanism that how does that happen? Why
don't
you do that?
Well, so, you know, lawyers love gray area vagueness, right? So I don't mean to sound like a lawyer and respond vaguely, but to me, if I was going to elect to use sugars, it would be a feel-based thing. And I'd be running that 9-11 test, right, when the parts per million get down to 1,100, safely feed up to 9, right? And I'd be watching for those PPMs late in flower. And if they're getting way down, and if my plants look a little tired, they're just not getting the pop, I might elect to use some sugars. But in most of you, following everything this man has taught you for, well, how long has it been? 12, 13 years?
A lot.
Yeah, a veritable YouTube university. There's a reason you never talk about sugars, because they're not necessary, all right? If you're, like I said...
If your soil's already popping, you already got good microbial stuff, you don't need to make it go more crazy.
Why would you overwhelm what's already there, you know? I mean, it's kind of like probiotics in our guts versus the microbes that are already there, the prebiotics, and it's actually better to feed the microbes that are already colonizing our guts than to, you know, try to spike them. So I guess you are doing that, but I've seen people go completely cattywampus with this and totally over-spike with sugars, and then you get what's called a bacterial bloom, where the microbes feast on, like a bunch of lemmings throwing themselves off a cliff, they'll feast on everything in the sugars that they've been spiked with. So it's kind of like us with diabetes and hypoglycemia. It's incredible, the parallels, actually, with your soil. It really is, because, you know, I always say, we're not what we eat, we're what we absorb in our guts. It's the same with your soil. At the end, a little bit of this in a plant that may, like if the PPMs are really low and you want it to pop a bit more, you can also take bricks, you can harvest some leaves and juice them. At that point, you should be harvesting lower leaves. You can juice them and test the bricks in your leaves, and just for shits and giggles, excuse my French, you know, try half and half, spike them with some sugar. Maybe they all look healthy and happy. Go ahead and spike some and leave the others, and then get a refractometer is what it's called, the tool. I've never bought one.
0 to 32 bricks refractometer. Yeah.
A refractometer, what are they, a couple of hundred, $300?
Nah, you can get cheap one, analog for like $20 on Amazon. Wow. I got a digital one, they're over $100.
About
I'm tripped out.
Okay, you know, nothing crazy.
Whatever.
So someone who really values their health, he wants to eat every vegetable, every fruit at its peaks of
highest bricks ever.
Bricks content.
Not just the sugar content, but also the
bricks.
More importantly, mineral content and total solids, which are, you know, include other nutrients.
Yeah, and speaking of nutrients and detrients, that some of these products are deliberately adding detrients. So what's the point? Detrients kill microbes in soil. So you're going, oh, you're going to get your microbe frenzy with being a microbe herder with these overpriced sugars and water, but you're also going to throw in some of these chemotocracy-fueled detrients. And so, really, just like, come on, man, this is bass ackwards, John, all of this. If anything spells out what's wrong with grow store culture, it's everything I'm looking at right in front of me.
All right, Josh, so with that, now that you guys know what not to use, let's go over to the other side of the table where we actually got natural, like, sugars, for the most part, that you can buy at a grocery store that actually are sold for human consumption that we could eat that also, guess what? Microbes eat too. So now we got basically the grocery store sugars you can buy at a grocery store, or even maybe better yet, a health food store. We got all kinds of sugars here. We got basically the organic brown sugar, pure cane powdered sugar, that's like white sugar. We got granulated cane sugar, organic sugar in the raw, organic brown coconut sugar, raw agave syrup. We got pure raw unfiltered honey, maple syrup, caro dark corn syrup, organic molasses in a small bottle, and date syrup, and of course we got the organic sucanat. So Josh, if you got to pick one of these sugars, which one would you use?
If it was cost no object, I'd probably pick the coconut sugar.
Because the coconut sugar.
I keep hearing really good things about coconut sugar. If I change Boogie Brew's recipe, I'm tempted to launch a new, maybe you should encourage me to, I'm afraid of success, a Caliwana Boogie Brew, Caliwana Boogie Tea. That might be the sugar I use in it. Because right now we use sucanat. So, you know, when do you use these? People ask me all the time, should I add bricks to tea? Not our tea. But if it's your own homemade workhorse tea, with which I tell people to make more of that and less boogie brew, then you want, you know, your typical vermi tea is going to be mostly worm castings, maybe some wood chip compost, little kelp and rock dust to act as catalyst ingredients. But the main microbe food in a compost tea is still sugar. I mean, we had aminos and
well, I would argue kelp might be even more beneficial than sugar.
Yeah, because, well, it also has carbohydrates
right,
in it.
I know, right, but right, it's right, a different kind of carbohydrates right, that feed different microbes.
Well, so then that should be in here too, because kelp with its potassium and its unique carbohydrate and its hormonal stimulating qualities also has Brix boosting. We're going to talk about non-sugar Brix boosters.
Yeah, we'll get to that. I think non-sugar Brix boosters are even more powerful, personally.
We're going to get to that in part three. So we're on part two, the sensibly priced sugar patrol. If you're going to do sugars, you know, any of these are an infinitely better choice.
Well, the maple syrup's kind of expensive at $9. Some of these are cheap as like $2.
And then the Caro's pretty evil.
Yeah, that's corn syrup
this is
with
GMO
other crap
corn.
In there.
Yeah, you're supporting a lot.
And then the other thing is, you know, just like I wouldn't use white powdered sugar.
Right,
that's
right.
Like devoid of everything except this. You know, I think I like some of the brown ones like you got because it has maybe at least a little bit more mineral content.
Well, what would you fuel your body with? You
know, actually, I would use a date syrup myself.
Right, okay, so yeah, he would like the date syrup. I would pick
maybe
the coconut.
Some honey or some maple syrup.
I heard good things about coconut sugar for the human body, too.
I wouldn't do coconuts.
There's electrolytes in it.
I would just do coconuts.
Well, he's a health Nazi, right? So, I mean, the
Well, yeah, I mean, for your garden, maybe I would do the coconut sugar. Compared to most sugars, I agree.
And even in the human diet, coconut sugar is way better than your typical sugar.
Date sugar is
right,
the best, man.
So date is the best. They have a dry date sugar.
So that's what I use. I use powdered date sugar, which has a lot more fiber than a regular sugar.
I mean, anything that's unprocessed, you're going to get hella mineral content, which you always want in any sugar, whether it's for human consumption. I mean, the more simple, the more lethal, you know, the more, I mean, this stuff's poison, the white version, you know, and sucanat. And the date sugar are practically a whole food. You know, why is that?
I would argue with you on the sucanat being a whole food.
Well, cane juice is drunk as a health tonic, as a mineral rich.
I agree. I make cane juice and I juice it myself, but it's not a whole food because you're removing like the fiber, like the majority of the fiber.
Well, you could argue that about any juice.
You could. You're keeping some of the. Yeah, this is not a fiber episode or juicing video, but yeah, depending on the fruit or vegetable you're juicing. Like, you could retain 50% of the soluble fiber, or even getting rid of it. So you could, like, in pineapple juice, only keeps 10% of the soluble fiber. Carrot juice keeps about 50%. I mean, shit, why don't we just juice fruits and then feed that fruit juice to our plants instead of buy all this hoser stuff?
You should do that, dude. You should do
it. Better yet, I would use other polysaccharides, like I'm going to make a video on, like, blending my aloe vera polysaccharides and then feeding, because polysaccharides, those are carbohydrates, too, and those feed different microbes, and I think those are even advanced shit. I mean, that's why they feed aloe polysaccharides, like, high-end growers.
Dude, you know.
Next level shit, dude.
You know your shit when it comes to health. And
helping me and health of the soil, they're right. Like intermixed, man.
They really are.
We don't need all this processed.
You know what?
Crap.
You need to do that in the future, some sort of raised bed comparison where you use fruit juices that you
But you gotta,
yourself.
You see, the whole thing is, I guess on the other level, it's cool because that sugar is a lot more diluted than some of this stuff. It's so concentrated because you're taking out the water.
Yeah.
But with the fruit juice sugars, you're also getting a lot of other nutrients that could also benefit the microbes in your soil.
Maybe. You know, this
do
is...
both, bad both. If you're experimenting, do what I'm doing, but if you want to be hardcore.
Who out there is going to show us, which Martha Stewart of agriculture can show us, you know, or tell us, or come up with the best sugar campaign, if you're even going to use it? The sucanat, it's a whole cane juice that's then dehydrated, right? And you can taste the minerals. I mean, if you don't mind, if I can take the liberty...
You could taste it. Yeah, show everybody what it looks like. Look at the color on that stuff.
The minerals melt.
Look at your leg, this man.
Yeah, the minerals melt in your mouth. They really do. You can taste them. But he's right. I mean, it's still concentrated. It's being stripped of its fiber. It's going to cause a high glycemic response. It is, compared to eating a fiber-rich sugar. But nonetheless, I mean, this is so healthy compared to... Any dried sugar. And back in the 90s, when I would read on those ganja forums, this was the microbe herders stimulant of choice.
But wait, why didn't you use, like, molasses? I mean, molasses, so many growers use molasses, dude. That's, I mean, that's brown.
You're getting a lot more bang for your buck in Sukhanat. You're paying for a dry product. I mean, I can get 50-pound bags of this at Keith Justo's grain supply. If you have any natural, local baking supply places, baking, you know, non-GMO flour distributors, they can get this. Wholesome Sweeteners, Unfi, United Natural Foods, who sell to all the independent non-Whole Foods health food stores, they distribute this. You can get it in bulk for $2 a pound.
So, way less.
Way less. And you know, most of the mineral content that's in molasses, I mean, there's the heavy carbon footprint of a liquid. I mean, admittedly, it's a concentrated liquid product. The bucket that's out of the picture here, which I still think is a great deal. If you're going to pay for a plastic jug of anything, I guess the feed grade store industry molasses. The food grade one in whole food form is certainly more mineral rich. You know, ultimately, you just have to ask yourself, you're using these sugars to spike microbe activity in your soil. At the end of the day, I don't think your microbes really care whether you've spent $5 a pound or $2 a pound. If it's a quality sugar that isn't just devoid of life, like the Cara would be the Dedrian.
Don't put that in your body.
Yeah, I wouldn't put this in the soil.
Or in the soil.
If there's anything you could pay me not to use, it would be this. Because God knows what this is, glyphosate rich. There's glyphosate residue in this. This is GMO corn. This is corn syrup. Like, as bad as HFCS, high fructose corn syrup, is for humans. So I can't imagine using this. I've never heard of anyone using this. That's pretty bad. I mean, you have to be pretty desperate to use this in a compost tea recipe. Maple syrup, I've heard great things about maple syrup. So again, I mean, this is local to you, and you're a city in Wisconsin, you have bitching maple syrup. How are you?
I don't know if I'd waste. Well, it depends. Yeah, you have some non-food grade maple syrup that's like messed up.
Yeah, but look,
use that in the garden.
You know what though? This is so cheap compared to all the grocery store crap.
Yeah, I agree. And actually, you know, there's polyphenols in there that can also feed the microbes. But make sure, you guys, get the very dark ones, not the light ones.
Right.
They're healthier for you.
The ones that are less refined. The less refined, the better.
Well, you want late season, they have more polyphenols, and it's, you know, it's not quite as sweet.
I mean, this is the same brand, Wholesome Sweeteners.
Yeah, but this stuff is like the brown sugar.
But there's so much molasses in that one. There's so much molasses. It's dripping. It's sticky, you know. That's one of the sugars in our Brix recipe. Mm.
So why don't you just share, dude, what's in your Boogie Brix recipe? Because, I mean, you use natural sugars. Like, how can somebody make this and they don't have to buy it from you? Save them some money right now.
Well, I tell everybody not to buy my Brix. So my Brix is like me. It's like my tea, you know. I'm insecure. I'm over the top. I talk a lot. I never talk poop. I want everyone to like me. I try too hard. I did the same with my tea with 18 ingredients. And I tell you all, you don't always need to use Boogie Brew. In fact, the last thing I want is people feeling obligated to use Josh's amazing Bo Granola one-stop shop 18 ingredient veganic Boogie Brew tea, which is a great product. And so is Brix, and not a bad value either, but you just don't need it. So, as I said, this stuff is, you know, it's a bit over the top. We use the Maxi Crop, the water-soluble kelp extract. That's really expensive.
Oh, see, that's hard. See, that's what I would use.
Right, we use some of that.
Once again, that feeds microbes
so
right
three,
there.
Three different kinds of sugars, all with different glucose to fructose to inulin, whatever, you know, we're trying to do a diverse portfolio, just like I would in a bike race. You know, back when I raced in my 20s, I didn't want just some simple sugar, you know. I wanted to, you know, slow absorption and so on. So I just approach it the same way I do with, like, you know, maybe a spirulina smoothie back in the day, you know, before a bike race. So for sugars, you know, I want a broad range.
That's the best, I think. I would agree with you on that, because you want a range, because different sugars and different molecules and polysaccharides are going to feed different microbes.
Right. So why is this at least $6 a pound when you buy, well, you know, I'm paying $2+ for these, and then I have to pay to mix these. And these are a pain to mix.
And the kelp's,
you know,
a lot more
and
money
then the kelp is, oh my God, you know, $10 and then the aminos are $8 a pound, my cost. So, and you just don't need them.
I would use them.
Yeah, but. And I have local grower customers who still insist on buying my Brix. And I'm practically pushing Sukhanat in their face.
Well, some people don't want to, like, mix stuff. Like, I'm not going to put together your 18-ingredient compost tea. I'm just going to use your compost tea because I couldn't make a better one. I'm not, like, you know, knowing all that stuff.
Yeah, and people pay for that, for the convenience, and I guess that's our market niche. But again, part of being insecure and wanting anyone to like me is I don't want anyone ever thinking that
you need it.
That you need it and that Josh needs to make a profit off of you, because I don't.
All right, cool, Josh. Well, with that, let's get to part three. And actually, that's what I do in my garden instead of buying all this sugar stuff. And actually, I do that in my personal, internal, probiotic-rich microbiome garden as well, because I don't advocate the use of eating additional sugars in your diet either. I don't think it's good for your health.
And I think any of these would be fine. The two I would avoid are the most processed. Obviously, your corn syrup and your powdered white sugar. Just approach it sensibly like you would in your own diet. What you want to put in your body, why would you not use those same, you know, parameters for your soil?
So now we're going to talk about part number three, and this is the most important part of the video that you will want to pay attention to, and this is actually how I grow my garden without the use of sugars. And people like TD, he doesn't spike his stuff with sugar, right? He uses just good growing practices the whole entire season. And for those of you guys that aren't aware who TD is, links down below for all six episodes I've made at TD's. I did his whole last growing season where we proved how you could make 10 pounds of flower with one plant by doing a lot of different things, but not by adding sugars or using hydroponic grow store ingredients. He doesn't use none of that stuff.
Deadrient free, DFZ. He's a deadrient free zone for sure.
All right, Josh, so we got all kinds of products here, and obviously they're all from Boogie Brew. So what are they, and why are they important? Why should people use these actually before the end of the season when they're just trying to spike stuff?
Well, just like if you're a well-nourished athlete and you shouldn't have to use a simple sugar, you know, a glucose spike at the end, if you've got the endurance, if you've built that, if you've herded the microbes properly and you've built them that pasture, that free range, that super healthy soil kingdom to live in, and that soil is a self-regenerating organism, a soil soup, a microbial matrix of mycorrhizal fungal pathways and microbe activity, then there's just no need to use sugars. Amino acids are highly underrated in boosting BRIC's value, and there's actually been research done, and that's why Ed Zybura, the genius behind Pure Protein, sells this stuff to the berry growers on the Central Coast. It's an open secret. There's a lot of berries grown, blueberries and strawberries between Santa Cruz and San Luis Obispo, even further down, he's at by Arroyo Grande.
I had some really good strawberries this weekend.
And an organic berry grower, like the word BRICS is in the back.
That's in their head. You want, because most berries you buy in the store are low garbage BRICS.
Right, and they're all focused. And even orange growers, all fruit growers are going to, like, the word BRICS is part of their
grape
vocabulary.
Grape growers, specifically wine growers, like, they know what BRICS is, because you can have high BRICS to make the wine.
They see it in their, they see that word in their sleep at night. So, and they don't use any sugars, you know, but they'll do, they'll do a spray with a high nitrogen content amino acid. But like I always say with the Pure Protein, it don't matter what time of the season, or excuse me, what stage of the crop's life cycle you use it in, you can spike, I mean, ideally with a foliar, of course with cannabis or with any dense flower that could mold, you don't want to spray anything at the end, but, you know, depending on the crop that's being grown, fruit trees, you spray with this towards the end, that amino acid bath, they absorb the aminos they need, they naturally biodegrade in the soil, the ones they don't, which just helps fungal growth anyways, and it's been documented, that boosts BRIC's value. So once again, my favorite product.
And how in a grow, Josh, how often would you use it? Like, how often does TD use it, for example?
So, I mean, the best way to use Pure Protein is every 2 weeks as a foliar feast.
2 weeks.
With diluted tea as the base, half strength on the product label instead of 4 tablespoons a gallon in water, 2 tablespoons in a 1 to 5 diluted Boogie Brew or rich workhorse tea. And that combo is amazing. From the probiotic mix of a good compost tea or a vermi tea, of a good Boogie Brew tea, with half strength, 2 tablespoons foliar. However, once you get to week 4, week 5, when you're down to 3, 4 weeks to go, stop spraying. But by that point, you've loaded the tissue, you've loaded the skeletal structure of the plant up with so much amino acid baths, you're going to keep driving those high BRIC's values in the plant itself. And this is one of the ways to get high BRIC's right out of the plant tissue itself, without doing that whole feeding the soil microbes thing. That's the miracle of aminos.
It goes right in.
Yes.
You're kind of avoiding the whole...
It's a direct injection when you do it that way, yeah. Of course, late in the, you know, in the cycle, you now are faced with drenching soil. I wouldn't do this. It's too expensive. I would just stick with, you know, the sugar if you want to soak or flush your soil.
Yeah, so I mean, I, as a vegetable gardener, grower, primarily myself, you know, this is what I use a lot to, once again, build amino acid levels, because now my plants are more resistant to stress, the stressors of the climate, the weather, the bugs, disease, and also, you know, they stay a lot greener. And also I'm building that in their tissue so that the foods that I grow in my garden taste a lot sweeter than the store.
I mean, I tasted weed grown by guys that were out in the patch in Arroyo Grande somewhere where they didn't have the luxury of bringing any sugars or even compost tea. This is the only product they could like backpack in. You know, we're talking gorilla patch, right?
Yeah, because this stuff's like light. Yeah,
right, lightweight and concentrated, yeah. And they could spray with it. And you know, they grew the best buds in just native soil in Central Coast, like Los Padres National Forest. Lime rich, whatever it was, you know, soil. It wasn't ideal, but by cheating with pure protein, and they got higher bricks. I know, I'm the guinea pig that tasted it. Okay, they got higher bricks than guys that were spending $1,000 on sugar supplements at the grocery store.
All right, Josh. So I know some of you guys out there are vegan hardcore, and yep. So what's the difference between this stuff, the water soluble amino acid powder from soy, versus the one from fish? If a regular grower is going to use combine these two, now you got better amino acid profile because you got the ones from the fish and the soy, or should you use this one or that one, or what's up?
I'll go foliar on this, and this is much more affordable, and the soil microbes really like this one. Soy, you know, it's like miso. There's a fermenting aspect to it that microbes really like. But you could also spray with this. And actually, from a bricks building perspective, this holds its own pretty well, the soy amino versus the pure protein. It's a bit cheaper. So that's, you know, for furnishing food to the plant itself and for nourishing the plant.
Go with this for the soil.
Yeah, both of them for the soil. But this is, I'm just saying, for if you're trying to use this for bricks, this is actually a better value. And it works pretty well.
Mm.
It doesn't work as well for building that skeletal tissue as a food for the plant, but as a food for microbes. This stuff is amazing. That's why it's one of the ingredients in Boogie Brew Tea.
So we talked about the amino products, and I'm going to show you guys what I normally do aside from foliar feeding with the aminos. I use the Boogie Brew compost tea, and I mean, Josh will talk you out of his tea, but I'm gonna tell you guys that the Boogie Brew tea is the tea I use because I don't wanna like source all the ingredients, and if I'm gonna take the time to make tea and brew tea, I'm gonna use like the best tea. I'm not gonna do some workhorse tea to try to save money because I wanna get the performance out of my plants and grow some high quality fruits and vegetables and even herbs. So Josh, tell us more about why people should use the tea, whether your tea or other teas, to build their microbial growth so that maybe they don't have to spike it with the sugars.
Oh, they definitely don't. If you've been using tea, if you've every week or every 2 weeks even, and if you've got that cake, you know, with worms in it and the mulching and all the other associated ways to keep a living biological bed going, teas are amazing. They're better than any sugars. And they're gonna keep everything just raging, that whole biocycle, that whole engine, that rhythm, you know, rolling, steamrolling right along. For pennies per gallon when it's diluted, which it should be in Boogie Brew's case towards the end when you're trying to flush anyway. I mean, 1 to 5 is really all you need. But you don't actually even need Boogie Brew. You can do great with getting amazing finishing performance and boosting those bricks levels and massive microbial stimulation occurring in soil with simple workhorse teas, like with my Caliwana castings and some Sucanat. And that's all you need. Just like Sucanat with a pinch of C90 is all you need. My viewers, you yourselves have taught me this works 80% as well as Boogie Bricks. Well, diluted Caliwana casting tea with just some sugar used, you know, a simple workhorse tea. Make sure you post a link to that.
Link down below to the workhorse tea recipe.
Which would just be castings, maybe a bit of compost, some sugar, and a little catalyst, maybe not, doesn't matter, but tea, baby, tea, brew, baby, brew, diluted teas, you know, 1 to 5, never more than 100 or 200 ppms of strength max in whatever teas you furnish. This is all, we're talking about towards the end, you know, we are mostly gearing this to cannabis growers, but you peach tree people, you know, you tomato, you know, flavor hunters, you know, this applies to you as well, but in the performance of a medical crop, of getting some high-grade flowers, this would be the last 2 weeks of flower for your cannabis life cycle, last 3 weeks max. Do diluted teas. Do a side-by-side. Tell me. I mean, we're all in this together. You've heard me say this before. You know, what we know about the soil universe is nothing compared to what we know about the cosmos. So Even the most gifted soil scientists on Earth know 1% of what's really going on, the life forms in the ground beneath our feet. And so this is all ground floor level, you know, experimenting with compost teas and sugars to stimulate microbial life. Just remember, in a redwood forest, the trees ain't making no compost tea, and there ain't no sugar falling out. It might be some fruit in an orchard, you know, that's breaking down, and the sugar's going into the soil. That, there's something to be said for that. When those early apples drop, and then their sugar content dissolves into the soil, that's arguably how the later, you know, the last, you know, sweetest of the fruit that you're picking, right, is arguably, it's benefited from some of that apple juice stimulating the microbiology in the soil around it. But yeah, instead of boogie brew, I would just stick with, I mean, boogie brew, sure, earlier for the building that engine and keeping that engine really healthy and happy. But then I would just go to simple vermi teas, just like in the off season, using simple vermi teas to, you know, to keep the soil really healthy and alive. And I mean, boogie brew's over the top, like its founder. It's a bit too much, you know, especially for just the simple purpose of stimulating microbiological activity in soil. You don't, less is more. You can just do cheap vermi teas and still, remember, it's 20% of my recipe are the quality of the worm castings that are in here, but it still represents 80% of the biological horsepower in any good compost tea recipe, no matter what high-grade exotic foods and catalyst ingredients I add to it. That is the essential power, the torque, in a good compost tea recipe, is the quality worm casting. So vermi teas, high microbiological activity vermi teas, sweetened with sukana, you can't go wrong. You're gonna have an army, you're gonna microbe herding for days. And that's it, that's about all I've got to say about the sugars and when to use them, when not to use them, if they're necessary. You tell me, that's what we want, your feedback. We're all in this together, this is a team effort.
Cool, Josh, so what I was gonna say is this, like, guys, seriously, make sure you get the right worm castings if you're gonna make a workhorse tea. Don't just use any worm castings you get from the grocery store or the nursery.
Yeah.
Could be some crappy worm castings. I've seen all kinds of worm castings. One, you know, ones made for the bait industry that's just like the poop from the worms for made for bait.
Actually, that stuff's really good.
Well, depends, man.
A lot so of that, anyways, that's like insect
you've
got to
make sure you guys get the good castings, you know, the Caliwana castings in my performance testing that I did that I never put out the video on because the video got messed up. You know, perform quite right up there with some of the best ones.
With OGS? The worm plus, tell me the truth.
The OGS.
How was it? Neck and neck.
It's comparable. I can't say which one's better, but it's like, I don't, we got mixed up, dude, so I don't know. But anyways, right. I'm giving it my this is some good, right, solid worm casting.
Neck and neck. It's a good,
I don't know.
I'm still, good enough for tea.
You get enough for tea.
Yeah, if you give me the choice,
OGS or this, I'm going to still choose OGS,
yeah,
dude.
Yeah, OGS.
But the best, obviously, the best for you guys, too.
Yep.
Mix them both. Buy OGS, buy this, buy the worm gold, mix all three, because now you have the benefits of all three. And then add your own, too.
Make your own.
Because each one, the worms are only as healthy and their poop is only as healthy as the food they're being eaten.
Make your own. Make worm tea for days. You can't go wrong, you know. You can't. You really can't.
Cool, Josh. So to sum this video up, at the end of this video, finally, you know, what's the summary for people that want to use sugars, maybe the best sugar, what they should do instead, or what would you just tell them just to, if they were stoned out of their mind like you were this episode, what would you tell them that they should remember?
We did film after 420. I had a long weekend in Humboldt. I came back, you know, spoiled with some local flavors, shall we say. I would, you know, do whatever the cheapest bulk local options are to you. If you can get a killer deal on feed grade store molasses, if you have that baking connection on things like sukana, or, you know, the next best, the turbinado, the really dark, sticky, you know, molasses rich sugars, and a pinch of salt, that salt and sugar fix, if you're gonna do that. Very little salt. The last thing you want to do is spike. You can also do a pinch of Epsom salt, for that matter, and that's what the overpriced products. And there is some evidence, and I don't know enough about it. You know, I'm not a scientist. I've never claimed to be. That's why I don't really make any concrete claims about anything I actually sell, you know. So I'm not trying to be some expert that, you know, I'm just good at talking. I love an audience, you know. You want to be a better farmer, remind the boogie boy, when does Zip hit? That's it.
All right, so that's the best sugar, Josh. But now what about building their microbial herd so they don't have to maybe add the sugars?
They should be, you know, biochar and everything he tells you in the last 12 years, you know, your mulching, your composting, your compost teas, all those sensible things. And then you can just kiss sugar goodbye.
All right, so there you heard it first from the boogie man himself, Josh from Boogie Brew, coming at you from the world headquarters of Boogie Brew here in NorCal. If you guys enjoyed this episode about learning about the sugars and what to do instead, or even the best budget sugar for you guys, hey, please be sure to give this video a thumbs up. Also, guys, please be sure to share this video with others so that they can learn how not to get fleeced by the grocery store industry and how to make their own budget sugars, and maybe even better yet, how to get off the sugars. And even if you guys are feeding it to your soul, I would say don't feed sugars to your soul. And actually, more importantly, don't feed sugars to yourself. It wrecks our microbiome inside of us, man. We need to eat like inulin-rich foods, fiber-rich foods, and other foods with prebiotic fibers, you know, resistant starch foods. Man, guys, eat your beans if you try to make your microbiome better. Eat your Jerusalem artichokes. You know, I could go off on this topic. And eat your sweet potatoes purple that have been heated and cooled. Anyways, so
hey, we didn't talk about that. Maybe potato starch. I mean, the parallels really are amazing with the human body and your soil. And if you feed the soil the way you would intuitively feed your human body with the right superfoods without getting ripped off, without paying for some label of some health food product, right? Just approach it with the same degree of common sensibility. It's that simple. So hey, thanks for watching. This was a fun one. I hope this one gets you a lot of traction, John.
And I hope this gets out to a lot of you guys to change how you grow so that you can grow higher quality stuff more in a natural way. Biologic, organic is what I like to call it, in accordance with nature.
And we put all those sugars out because we know that there isn't someone out there that's watching this video right now that, you know, go back to the beginning of the video. All of those sugars, there's at least one of you out there that has used one of those, or all of them maybe, you know? I mean, I've got some customers, and let me tell you, talk about nerds. Some of your viewers, like, my God, they're soil nerds and microbiology nerds. They really are, which I love, you know? We learn more from you, but like I keep saying, we're all in this together. So, you know, this was fun. Yeah, definitely, we want your feedback is my point. This video's not over yet, right? We need to learn from you all too. Like, which of you have had the best results with the coconut versus the date or the honey, you know? Like, seriously, those of you who have nerded out and truly experimented with sugars, give us your honest feedback.
Yeah.
Not what the grocery store lady seduced you with, but what you honestly, knee-jerk, feel-based reaction was, you know, the best bang for your sugar buck. And if you even needed, and as a lot of you, like TD, that have used sugars and not used sugars and got the exact same results.
Mm. If you're doing it right, your soil is. If your soil is shitty, use sugar. If your soil is already super good, probably don't need sugars.
That is true. I mean, the grocery store industry stuff is all based around the deadrient model. It's hilarious. You know, they sell you all these poisons, and you go in there and kill everything, and then they sell you these magical, you know, microbe stimulating whatever. It's just like you're dreaming. You're dreaming if you think you go in there and you're gonna, and any of that stuff is gonna make a lick of difference. You really are dreaming. So anyway, thanks for letting me yell that at you.
No worries, Josh. All right, so if you want updates on this video and more videos with Josh in the future, because I try to do it maybe like once a month, because it's always fun when Josh and I get together.
For some reason, you love our chemistry, you know? So,
yeah.
I don't know. The French trust the people who squabble publicly and sort their poop out, and that's definitely been my frenemy and friend for a long time. So we're here to keep giving you what you want. You know?
Keep you entertained too, and teach you some stuff at the same time. So click that subscribe button right down below so you don't miss out on my new and upcoming episodes that come in every 5 to 7 days. Make sure you click the bell so you get notified as my new videos come out. And finally, be sure to check out past episodes. The past episodes are wealth of knowledge. Over 1,600 episodes on this channel teaching you guys all about how to grow organic biologic gardening, whether you want to apply that to fruits and vegetables, herbs, nuts and seeds, you know, roots and tubers, or flowers and cannabis. You know, I'm covering you guys because I want you guys to grow the highest quality stuff you can
really
possibly grow.
Over 1,600 now?
1,600, yeah, and I'll put a lot of videos with that I've made with Josh in the past down below, including that powerhouse workhorse tea recipe, and also all the video links.
Yeah, and the open source. There's the open source.
Yeah, and the open source compost tea recipe.
With the sucanat.
So that you don't have to buy his compost tea if you want to, like, make it yourself. Maybe save some money, but also have a lot more time invested.
Yeah.
So all that is down below. Check out the description down below. And so with that, my name is John Kohler with growingyourgreens.com. We'll see you next time. Until then, remember, keep on growing.